Camera's rolling.
Camera's rolling.
Camera's rolling. So there's camera one, camera two.
Knock mine down just a little bit on the headset.
You got it. There you okay. go. How's that?
That's wonderful. How I'm on the speaker.
Good. Sound good.
Okay. Yeah, you're just saying that.
And then all your stuff looks good down there. I am now going to let this thing warm up.
Okay.
I'm going to take a break, too. Usually, this is our break time anyways. We're wrapping up the show.
Yeah.
A little light down there.
Yes, I have. On air light. We are on air.
Well, the one downstairs says recording, so my dad always texts me, are you recording? Lives and die by getting the mail.
Yeah, well.
Dad, get an email address. All right. Deep breath.
Yep.
Good to go?
Yep.
Here we go.
And now for something special. The unit is self-contained with its own saddler, farrier, wheelwright, and so on. It's a rigorous training dished on who know all there is to know about horses, and it brings results. We take you behind the scenes now to show just some of the interesting aspects of this training.
Welcome to Equine Dynamics with Mike Stein, the best podcast to create sound of horses from the ground up. Mike Stein is a registered journeyman farrier with an APF 1 accreditation. On this week's show, we're going to talk terminology. We're going to talk forging and overreaching. Also, phases of the horse's stride. Again, this time we're going to focus on the hind limb. And also, case of the week study, we're going to talk about the horse named Peggy who had laminitis. All this and much more will be discussed here on Equine Dynamics with Mike Stein. And over to my far end side is Mike Stein. Got the ball up and rolling here.
Finally. Had a little tough time getting it together this morning. I messed you up, didn't I?
Well, the computer was sitting here waiting for both of us to get on the air and get going and stuff.
And it got tired.
And it got tired, and it was like waiting for you, waiting for me. And then all of a sudden it said, oh, you're ready to start the show? Shut down everything. I have to do an update. So we're a little behind schedule here, but hopefully we'll dredge through this and get you and create a great podcast for you to listen to. Good episode for you to listen to today.
Hopefully so, yes.
All right, Mike.
It will be good.
Are you doing okay over there?
I'm doing okay.
Well, I'm not doing good. You know, it always seems like I'm never doing well and you're doing okay.
Well, I just say that because it's just easiest.
Well, I say I'm doing okay. My wife, she has Diego. Diego is our four-year-old gelding. He's over at another facility during the wintertime because our arena gets kind of soppy and wet and stuff. During the rainy season that we have here in North Carolina. And so they've got a nice covered arena over there, so she can go over there and ride, rain or shine. She's got a place to go. In this facility has 30-some-odd horses. And So my wife, being that we live out in the middle of nowhere, we don't have a whole lot of interaction with horse people. So with her being out there at this place, this facility, she has 30 new horse friends that she talks to and she gets along with, and everyone, you know, how's your horse doing? How's your little girl doing? How's your little boy doing? Oh, he looks so pretty, you know.
He looks so beautiful.
All the horse talk stuff. Part of that is they have a Facebook thread as far as what's going on. I think someone posted the other day, hey, I've got farm fresh chicken eggs in the refrigerator. They're X amount of dollars. If anyone wants them, you know, leave the money in my tack room or whatever like that. One of the feeds that she got the other day was a friend of hers out there, the horse got compacted. Is that the right term that I'm using, compacted? As far as the intestines got
stopped up.
So they were blaming the weather.
Possibly, yeah.
So we have, like last week, we were in high temperatures around, I think, 72, 73 degrees. And then all of a sudden, this week, we've had freeze warnings for the last 4 days.
Right.
So her horse went into, what do they call that, the scenario where the horse goes into, what is it called? Is it called the horse has gone in compacted? Is it colicking? Is that colicking?
And they'll quit drinking and stuff quits moving through like it ought to.
So that's exactly what happened. So I guess when the cold weather came around, the horse quit drinking and it started to colic. And the sad part is my wife and this lady, the friend of hers, did a trail ride not even 24 hours prior to that. And the horse was fine. There was nothing wrong with it. And within 24 hours time, her friend went out there and saw that the horse was not doing well.
Right.
Rushed her to Tryon.
Sure.
What's the name of the facility out there?
Tryon it. trying equine?
Yes. Rush the horse out there, which is, how far is that? Like 3 hours away or something like that?
It depends on how you drive.
Jesus. Yeah. Can you imagine that? Imagine your kids, you got a child at home and the kid's sick and you got to rush it to a hospital 3 hours away. And that's the only one that to do this outside of having a local vet come out and do it. The reason
why they had the local vet there, I'm sure.
Yes, they did. But, you know, for surgery or something like that, 3 hours away.
24-hour treatment, whatever it takes.
Everything. So they did an MRI. They found out that, yes, it is compacted. They did a 3-inch incision. And I guess, do they go in there and physically with their hand try to untwist the balloon knot that's in there, or the party balloon? That's the only way I can describe their intestines is, you know, this twisted balloon that you get, a party balloon.
Right. You don't want a twisted party balloon unless you're just having a twisted party.
But, I mean, to get the stuff to move, is that what you do?
That's kind of out of my realm, you know?
Okay. Sometimes
they have had horses where they have had some dead intestine that they removed and put back together and everything else, and maybe they can massage it to get it to move through, or maybe they can untwist it. That's kind of a veterinary surgical question.
I didn't know if you've been there
been involved in having to do that.
Well, not you.
I have had horses colic.
Right, but I didn't know if anyone said, well, this is what we've done, A, B, and C. So I guess they got...
Sometimes riding them down the road in the trailer gets everything moving through.
Well, it didn't happen. So the horse was there overnight. And the next day they got the compacted unpacked. The thing is, the horse still couldn't eat. That section of the intestines, the way my wife described it, wasn't coming back to life. So, you know, it's got acid reflux, and they've got a tube sticking down the horse's nose that's caught up in the bridle to remove this acid and stuff. Horse isn't eating. Horse isn't drinking. Now, today's Monday, so this has happened all from Wednesday to Saturday.
Yeah.
This has been going on. So, just to let you know, the horse is fine.
Right.
It is now past a little bit of the stomach has come back to life. It is a term I've never heard before.
Okay, things are starting to work again.
Yes, but the horse does have this tube in the, you know, going down because of the acid reflux. Horses can't throw up or can't regurgitate, so they're using the tube. And I'm like going, well, what does the tube do? Does it just kind of leak out? And she's like, they basically suck it out. I go, like, you're pulling gas out of, you're stealing gas out of someone's car? Is that how you're pulling the acid out, or do they hook it up to a machine and kind of suck it out?
I think it sounds better if they're actually, you know, like starting to siphon. I don't know.
Well, when we had when we had Pepper here,
right?
The young vet that was here,
right?
She put the hose down Pepper's nose,
right?
And I think she did the you know, like the gasoline thing where you're trying to siphon everything out of the stomach, add the mineral oil to and that's what she did, and blew it in there so it would get down into the gut.
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, I guess the
major thing that I'm worried about is, you know, here we have horses, Mike,
right?
And you're familiar with, you know, you've talked about eventing horses, and these horses run 4 or 5 miles straight, jumping, sliding, moving, maneuvering up and down. You've got dressage horses that are trained with this movement. You know, these big, fierce draft horses and these race horses, these big, enormous animals that take all this abuse and all this beating. And I say abuse and beating, training. It's their job. It's what they do. And then just this simple twist of the weather sets them down. It's amazing that they're so enormous and so bold, but yet so fragile when it comes to the weather.
Yeah, it is. And, you know, with the weather changes and they quit drinking, we do have more colics in the area for sure.
And something that is coming up on this episode is something we need to worry about now. We're in the spring,
right?
So the grass is coming in,
right?
So what are we worried about now as far as, like, horses eating too much grass? Is it laminitis that we're worried about now this time of year?
We're worried about laminitis, and we also have to worry about laminitis in this part of the country in the fall, which people don't think about that because the cold weather grasses are coming back in, and you start dealing with the fescues and all that.
All right, guys. Well, make sure you follow us on YouTube for every podcast we do. We have a matching video here. Mike's looking at all these different parts and attachments that he's brought here in the studio. You can watch this right along with us as well. Go over to YouTube. Make sure you like and subscribe to Mike right now so you can see all this in real time as we're talking about it. All right, guys, stick around. We got a big show to get into, lots to talk about. So stick around. You're listening very important stuff this time of year. Stick around. You're listening to Equine Dynamics with Mike Stein. He'll be right back. I found my mojo in there somewhere.
You do have some mojo. I haven't found my mojo yet.
I'm trying not to ask you yes, no questions, so. Ready?
Okay. Yes. I got my feet in place, too.
Welcome back to Equine Dynamics with Mike Stein. He was the official farrier of the 2018 World Equestrian Games. And make sure if you have a question for Mike Stein, you go over to equinedynamics.com, fill out that little form there, says contact us, ask us a question, we'll answer it here on the air. And make sure you put a return address and we'll send you out some magnets, some stickers, some keychains. We have some new coasters, and Mike's got, we're going to do the best question. Last week we said the best question for March, but there's only a couple shows in March. We'll do the best question asked for season 5. We'll get a t-shirt. So make sure you hang on to at least one of those t-shirts. Okay.
I was supposed to hang on to one of them.
Would you cut them up and use them as oil rags?
Well, shop rags.
Yeah, yeah, shop rags. But no, we're going to do the best question of season 5. Get yours in now. And then we'll announce the winner on the first episode of season 6. So get your questions in now. And the way you do that is go to equinedynamics.com. At the top of the page says contact. Says, and then drop down menu says podcast, fill it out. Make sure you put a return address in there as well. And over to my far end side is Mike Stein. How are you?
I'm doing good. Travis, how are you?
I'm doing well. Now that we're up and running and the program is, I think my computer's stopped being fickle. Maybe it had some compactness or something.
We'll give them some fickle no matter what, right?
Maybe my computer had some compactness in it and it had to be surgery.
Revitalized.
Yeah, something like that. Now, right now, we have a new segment, and it's been taking off. A lot of people appreciate this segment. It's called Talking Terminology. Now, this week, basically what we do is we grab a couple terms that you might hear in the barn through your farrier, through your veterinarian, just anyone that's working on your horse at any given time. You might hear this terminology, and people go, they just assume, I understand what that means. So Talking Terminology, we kind of dive into actually what these words mean, these terms that you are hearing actually means. So today we're going to talk about a term that you might hear called forging and overreaching. Now, forging or interference is the fault of a horse's gait, which results in the toe of the hind hoof striking the sole of the front hoof at the same time. So you're kind of like stepping on your own heels.
Right. Well, not quite. Not quite. That's the next one.
Okay. So
that's overreaching.
Oh, that's overreaching. All right. So overreaching is the fault of the gait where the toe of the hind hoof contacts the back of the forelimb. Sorry, that's where it is. So, Mike, tell us about forging and tell us about overreaching. Yep. All right. We're going to switch screens here. So Mike will show you. Actually, he's got some horses' actual hoofs here. And right. It'll show you here on the screen what's going on.
So when a horse is forging, the foot is starting to break up and you can hear this foot come in. And sometimes you can hear, if there's metal to metal, sometimes you can hear the shoe hit, as far as like a trot on your diagonal limb or whatever it may be. Overreaching, they'll come through, and this foot may not have started into breakover, and it may come and catch on to the bulbs of the heels. Or, you know, it's faster gaits come up into the back of the leg or the tendon.
All right, so forging is basically
forging, they're going to come into the bottom of the foot.
And they're kicking their feet out from underneath them. I used to do that with kids in school as they were walking. I used to come up behind them and kick their foot out from underneath.
I thought you were that kind of a fella.
I was.
I could see that in you, yes.
Get up, slowpoke. And so that means they're kicking up underneath their foot. And then overreaching is basically stepping on the heel.
Bulb of the heel. Sometimes, like if you're working at speed, they can come up, catch themselves in the back of the leg. Hit, you know, back of the fat, like back of the tendon.
Now, is this a normal movement that a horse does, or is there an underlying issue that this would happen?
Funny you might say that. We were talking about breakover the other week, right?
Correct.
Okay. If the foot is on the ground and it has not come up, we can alter breakover and get it to come here a little quicker as the hind foot's coming in, come up. And what you want them to do is come in and clear. if that makes any kind of sense.
Yes.
Where if he's just starting to break and I hit here, he's running a little slow and he hasn't gotten the back end, gotten the front end going, you can play with the break over. Now, also on that, one of the old things was, well, speed up the break over the front, slow it down on the back. Problem with that is, A, we can't make a horse longer. When you send one on a 10-mile trip, the front end and hind end is going to get there back at the same time. If you slow the back end way down, they end up like a weenie dog by the time they get there, right?
Right.
And also you end up hitting them in the lower back. So the deal is get the back end moving to where the front end can get moving, which may mean speed up the break over in the back end, sometimes even more, to get them off the shoulder so this can go. And if you got a horse that is being collapsed in the middle, if you're dropping their back out, you're going to slow this timing down as far as getting out of the way. If you got a horse that's up and around, this is going to clear real nice, and everybody's going to go on down the road. If you drop them in the middle, it's going to start hitting.
So the basic things, because I've said this a million times, I'm the simpleton as far as when it comes to horses and stuff. But the little things that I learn about is when a horse picks up its front foot, technically its back foot should be in that same footprint.
Yes, for and no, and some over and some under.
Okay.
Some horses will never step up there. Some will, as their track will come way past it, can. But they're going to have a lot of flexion in that back end and really moving through, and they've got to be really up strong.
So what's the idea or the ideal condition? Do you want that hoof, the rear hind leg hoof, replacing the front hoof as it lifts up? Is that ideal, or do you want it to be ahead of it or behind it?
That is one of the standards that we look for. Reality is it's going to vary from horse to horse. I've had horses that are very athletic where this will come up, and I've had 10 inches, the hind foot land 10 inches in front of the front foot. And this is an extremely athletic horse and a very good rider. Now, if you throw somebody up there that locks up the horse's shoulders, all of a sudden, you're going to be hitting, banging all over each other. A bad saddle, heavy in the hand. Slow down that front end. The back end's coming through and getting into it.
When you say that the rear hoof comes 10 or 12 inches in front of the imprint of the front foot,
right? I've had a couple horses that will do that.
I picture the horse physically bending and that back coming way up like a hump.
Yes,
to get in that position.
But real strong, a lot of flexion, a lot of lift, a lot of animation, yes.
And that's a bad thing?
Not if you want to win in the arena.
Okay. Well, I didn't know if that was bad for the horse to essentially just do the, like this, like bird
no,
wing.
The horses that will lift and round up, it's easier to keep them sound.
Okay.
And, you know, it's easier to keep. You start dropping them out in the middle, you'll start seeing compression problems, low palmar angle. You start dropping their back out, they start compressing the palmar angle down the front, which palmar would be front feet, plantar would be hind feet. You start dropping that plantar angle, you start losing flexion in the back end, start snelling them in the SI and all that sort of deal.
All right, so here's a loaded question. What's easier to fix, the forging part of a horse or the overreaching part of a horse? Or are they both the same?
You're going in the same general direction.
Mm-hmm.
It's determining what, when, and where. And that gets into watching a horse move out. And some of these issues can be if you don't, you know, people, well, we have to take the shoe out from under, don't put the shoe back there because he hits the shoe, right?
Right.
Well, then you take support away. And if you've already got a horse that's collapsing hard in the pasterns, sometimes you actually speed up the breakover by putting the support back there because of the recovery time of the pastern. I want to see that thing land, and it is going to settle, but I want to see it coming back up and being lifted fast enough. If you take the support out from under and it collapses hard, it takes too long for it to recover, and sometimes taking that base out from under them will actually create more of an interference.
Now, my wife's horse has these bells on the front shoes, on
right.
The front feet. Now, she doesn't ride in them.
They're for Christmas. They ring, you know, the sleigh bells.
Sleigh bells, right. What do the bells do on the front feet, and why wouldn't you have it on all four feet? Why does she only have it on the front feet of a horse? Or it's just because, and the horse I'm talking about is Dominique. Dominique is our mare. She's an 11-year-old mare, going to be a brood mare here soon. But why would Dominique only have bells on the front?
Well, normally you would only put those on the front, and it's try to keep a horse from overreaching and getting shoe grabs. Now, she is shot on the front. She right now, Dominique, we've pulled everything off the back because her work level is lower than it was.
Oh, so she doesn't have any shoes on the back.
She doesn't have metal on the back. Oh, okay. End, no. And, you know, that's going to change. We've got a low Palmer angle in the front end problem. So we're doing some stuff mechanically and with some materials to get that Palmer angle up to where it should be and get her more comfortable. Because remember, we had some problems with her shoulders and, you know, it's kind of front end or back end, where do you want to start? You know, and, you know, being that her performance, we're not looking for winning the dressage arena. We're just talking about a fitness deal.
Right.
And can she be okay? Like, she is fine if she is. If we need to do some mechanics to help her out further than that, we're okay, but she's happy enough. She's tooling along. She's still lunging, still doing a little bit of riding to keep her physical fitness level up. Now, when she starts producing babies, we're going to start looking at her a little different.
And what are we looking for different when you say that after she produces babies, what are we looking for?
Well, if...
Or looking at, I guess, in a different way.
Looking at. Broodmare's feet usually spread.
When left to right, like out?
Like out, okay. Yes. When they're carrying the extra weight of the baby. So does she need a shoe for that time? And also, when that baby is newborn, do you want, you know, when it's on the ground, if a mare ever steps on a baby, you want to disarm the mare a bit. You want metal off of them so they don't damage the baby if they step on them. You don't want that if you can help it. So ideally for a mare who is foaling, unless we've got some reason we just can't get her around it, you know, you would shoot for her being barefoot. And, you know, if you got a mare that you have to keep shod to get babies out of her, then there's other question. Is there something going on with this mare? Should we breed her or not? And is it worth that?
Can we put like little mommy slippers on her?
We can put mommy slippers on her. Yeah, they got mommy slippers these days.
Once she has a baby, you know, everyone's like, sure. Little mommy slippers. So
we
walk
can
around.
Do mommy slippers. If it makes you feel better, Travis, we'll do mommy slippers.
All right, guys, stick around. When we come back, last week we were talking about the stride of the front part of the horse. Now we're going to talk about the hind limb. And Mike's got a whole bunch of, joints.
Where's that bottle of sauce?
Yeah, it looks like you were at a barbecue restaurant and all your ribs or your bones are on the plate.
Right.
And you can see this. Go over to YouTube as well. Search for Equine Dynamics with Mike Stein. All right, guys, stick around. We'll be right back. Ready?
Yes. Hold on. Oh. I'm not ready. Got it.
Okay.
You got it.
I got it. Welcome back to Equine Dynamics with Mike Stein. He was the 2017 American Eventing Championship Farrier. And for every podcast we do, we have a matching video over on YouTube as well. Make sure you like and subscribe to the YouTube channel, Equine Dynamics Mike Stein over on YouTube. And you can see we got all these different cameras in here. You can see me waving to Mike waving to me. Hi, Mike. And he's got a whole bunch of different bones and joints and hoofs and stuff here in the studio. And he's going to show you the phases of the hind limb this week. So what are we looking at here, Mike? Let me switch camera so everyone can see it and we can all be friends here. So what are we looking at here? I see a bunch of hooves and I see like a knuckle. Looks like some...
You got a coffin bone, okay. You got hooves, and we got a knuckle.
Okay.
Actually, this is a hock joint.
You got to put it in front of the camera, Mike, so everyone can see it. This camera here.
Yeah. Okay. All right, if I get everything turned the correct way where it fit together.
All right, so move everything off your plate over there. Move the hoofs and everything off your plate in front of you.
A plate.
Yep, move all that out of the way. Move the coffin bone out of the way. And then lay down the bones there so flat so we can see it on the camera. There you go. All right. So what are we looking at here?
This is a hock joint.
Okay.
And the major motion joint is what's up top here.
Now, is in your left hand, is that the top of the horse or the bottom?
This is the top of the horse. Okay. This is the bottom of the horse.
Okay.
And that's your major. You do have some movement in these lower joints. They have been glued together, you know, so that you can see what happens with the hock itself.
Mm-hmm.
And in this joint, there's actually a wear point within the joint. There you go.
Hold on, I'm going to switch here. All right, Hold up to the camera right here in front of you.
What camera? You keep changing cameras.
Well, you can't stay on the same camera. There you go.
You can see an actual wear joint in the joint itself. Now, if I've got a horse that's flexing, you're going to see strong quadriceps, and this is going to be the shock absorber as far as the movement. If I've got a horse like a low Palmer angle horse where the flexor tendon is pulled tight around the hock and it drives it straight, and you start hitting impact this way, then you're going to start getting wear in the joints from impact. And that's the whole thing about, you were talking about flexing, not flexing. And it's not just the hock joint. If this goes straight, it straightens out the stifle joint, pushes the pelvis out from under it, and then you got a horse that's sore in the SI area. And that can be directly related to the plantar angle, which is...
Go ahead, don't mind me.
We're out in the breeze. Are we in the camera or not camera?
Yeah, we're on the camera.
Low Palmer angle and Palmer angle to a positive, Palmer angle to a negative. If you got a Palmer angle to a negative, remember that flexor tendon attaches here, goes back up around the fetlock, up over the hock to the flexor muscle. So if you drop this and pull this tight, it pulls this joint straighter. And because of the stay apparatus, this joint is directly connected to the stifle joint. If this is straight, stifle joint straight. And then when you're watching them move, that little dimple in the stifle joint you'll see on your heavier bodied horses, not as much in an Arab and all that, you're going to keep that there longer. And the other thing I'm looking at is how long is that pasture and how much is it dropping and how quick is the recovery time. And that's going to make some difference in how I start thinking about what I'm going to do with trimming, with what I do with a piece of metal on the back end. If we're dropping this, whether it's being forced down from the back end, I mean from the ground, or if you've got a back that's being hollowed out and you shove the pelvis out behind the horse, you get the same kind of reaction all the way down to the ground.
Now, we've got a diagram here of the phases. So let me switch cameras here so we can all see it. So what are we looking at here, Mike?
That is a diagram of the horse.
Of the hind end phase?
Of the hind end of the horse.
Okay.
And, you know, when the horse is coming through and pushing, that first part of the phase is you kind of cross lines between, you know, the leg is extended out the back, is pushing, it breaks off the ground, then it starts to flex up and swing under. And then it extends forward and comes back to the ground and starts to load again.
Now, last week we had five. You said there was five stages actual of
right.
The front end. So the
you
rear
can break
end,
them down to about 20 some odd stages or more if you get real picky about every flexion of every joint.
But this one, the hind end phases of the stride of the rear end, we have a swing phase, the impact or the grounding,
right.
The loading, and then the thrust to break over.
Right. Yeah, and it's kind of like this. When you're looking at the hind end of a horse, when they bring them out, if I've got a horse that is really flexing and thrusting, the shape of the hind end is going to be different than one if I've got that pastern dropping and it's pulling through with the hind leg straight. You're going to get a lot of load development down in the hamstrings if he's pulling through with the hind leg straight. And you're going to not have the strong quadriceps, and you're not going to be as round in the rump. If you got a horse that is round in the rump, got good strong quadriceps, he's flexing and pushing harder. If that is real working real straight back there, he's dragging himself forward on the front end.
So what were you saying? What was your creed as far as the back is the motor?
The hind end's the engine.
The engine, the motor.
You got to have that motor running. You got to have it running strong. For a horse to propel itself forward, you've got to have proper flexion of the leg. When he comes through and picks up weight, that pastern will drop a little bit and recover plenty fast enough. And at that point, the leg can start flexing. And when it's flexed, he can push. And he needs to push. And you know, he's come through, he's reaching, he's lifting his body. And as it crosses under the hip, he's really starting to drive forward and push. And then that goes all the way through to your breakover phase where that heel starts to come up. And he comes up to that toe. Now, on breakover phase, when he's coming up to that toe, he's still driving. and he's driving real hard. And as far as the body reaction, well, then you start getting into different materials they're working in, and you're going to get a little reaction, a little different reaction from clay to sand to synthetics. And also, when we're looking at them from a fairy aspect, you got to start taking that into consideration. So it starts getting complicated when you start throwing all those different synthetics in there.
Now, does all this translate across the whole entire spectrum of what horses compete in? For example, you have your derbies,
mm-hmm.
You have your eventing, you have your hunters, your jumpers, your dressage. What else do you have?
You have your Western horses, you have reiners, you have racers, roping horses, and whatever it may be. Yeah.
So does all this still translate? It's like, this is the basic, this fits every unique pattern as far as what the horse is actually physically doing for their job, whether it be dressage, whether it be a derby horse or a race horse.
Right. This carries across. Now, if I'm looking at racehorse shoeing, well, that's a totally different deal from a dressage horse. And the way we manage situations is going to vary with a dressage horse versus an event horse versus a race horse versus, in particular, a rein horse. That's a very specialized deal on your Western horse that do the rein and the slides and all that, as far as how they manage the back end and what they put on there.
And I guess that's the reason behind my question. My wife rides dressage.
Right.
So when you say the back end is a motor, I can physically, in my mind, go, okay, the motor of the horse is what's pushing the horse to run fast. Racehorse,
right.
Eventing horse, all that stuff. Dressage is not that, it's not, there's no motor. It's more.
There's supposed to be a motor.
I know there's supposed to be a motor, but it's more of the gait. It's more of the movement of the horse. So, sorry. The ending of the show popped up there. But there's not a physical motor like, 600 horsepowers of, nonstop performance pushing that horse forward. It's more of a gait, so I don't know where I'm going with the question.
Where's your horse going when it's going forward? How's it going forward?
Well, it's moving, but it's no
different. What's moving it?
It's hind legs.
Right.
But if you're a golfer, you got to walk from hole to hole. Their body's shaped totally different than a linebacker or a front end tackle.
Right.
You would think that they would have a more motor in their hind end than a golfer or
With a dressage horse, if they're doing it correctly, you got to think more lifting power.
Okay.
It's not necessarily a lot of huge forward momentum. It's lifting power, picking up, doing squats.
I have a hard time doing squats.
Well, you're not a dressage horse. Or maybe you are.
I'm far from it, Mike. I'm far from it.
If they're running inverted, they're not doing squats. Uh-huh. But you've got to have that, as far as longevity, you've got to have that motor working. You got to have them doing squats. You got to have them doing picking themselves up. And if you got a horse where that pastern's collapsing too hard and it's not recovering, well, then they're not picking themselves up. So then what do we do about that? And the sport that they're in is going to vary from a lot of what I work on is more sport horse oriented, whether it be 3-day eventing or dressage or a show jumper. You're going to manage each one of those a little bit different if I've got too much pastern collapse. But you've got to be able to play between them. And then you look at your reined horses in particular, where you're creating a lot of slide in a dressage horse when they're coming in that ground to the ground. Sometimes on the synthetic surface, we have to do some work to create a little more glide as the foot comes in, because if it's not gliding, we got that sudden stop. Well, this is beating up the suspensories, and that's a whole nother animal, because when the horse first comes in loads and we're stopping that leg and snapping the pastern forward, slamming it down on the suspensories, how many dressage horses are going out with suspensory injuries in both front or back? Now, if I've got a horse that is purely, a 3-day event horse, and he's also got to have traction on cross country, well, that's a different critter. And I got to have him there on the cross country phase. And I've got to be able to set him up where he can work in the dressage arena and then turn around and do cross country. With a dressage horse, you're primarily looking at that arena. So I can forge out the front of the shoe and get a little bit of an effect like a sliding plate, where if he's coming in, especially the more collected they are, the easier it is for them to land on the toe. And I want that toe to glide when it hits the ground a bit.
So it's more the up more than the down.
If you've got, it's like somebody's talking about, well, in different phases, if you do a basically a trot in place, he's almost got to land on the toe. If you do a real extended trot, well, that's a different thing. They're landing heel first, and you've got a racehorse that's galloping at, you know, working at speed. If he lands toe first, he's probably going to cut a flip. You know, there's a lot of forward energy, and he's coming in heel first, and that foot's coming in, it's gliding on that surface and sitting into it. Then goes into the driving phase, comes up, flexes, and pushes through. But they got a lot of motor going on with those horses, and it's a lot more forward. With a dressage horse, do it correctly, he's lifting and carrying his body through it, picking it up. He shouldn't be falling forward, but if I got too much drop in the pastern, he is falling forward. Then he locks up the front end. Then he beats up the front end. Then you end up with more tendon ligament problems and lamenesses in the front end from hammering on it. If I've got a rider up there that cannot get up out of the horse's way and cannot use the leg in the correct way to get the horse to lift, and I've got a bad saddle up there that does not allow him to lift and is uncomfortable for him to lift, if it's biting him in the back, he's going to duck out from under it. Hind end goes back out from under him, and he falls on the front end. And that's all you got to worry about.
Oh, is that all?
Just a bit. And then
a little bit.
If you got somebody that is not balanced and they're using the reins and the hands to balance, they freeze up the shoulders. If the shoulders are froze up, well, he gets all over himself and he starts overreaching and forging because he can't get his front end out of the way. We drop the back, push the hind out from under him, and then we start asking for these elevated maneuvers, and then we start treating suspensory and tendon ligament damage. How's that sound?
All right. I think you answered my question. All right, guys, stick around.
It's just a little bit involved, you know, not about one thing going on there. There's a lot going on. It's going on real fast, and you've got to learn to look at a horse, take in the situation, and make adjustments like boom, 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 fast. And, you know, I watch horses come into the barn, and I pretty much dead giveaway on that back end. I used to you got to say things to annoy people because that's what we do, right?
Mm-hmm.
So he's got the perfect 3-beat trot. I mean, excuse me, 6-beat, 6-beat, 3-beat on one leg, 3-beat on the other hind leg. But you get, you know, your diagonal legs. And if your horse is breaking over slow, he's coming and tagging the ground with his toe,
mm-hmm.
and then coming through and hit. Well, that's 3 beats on one side of a trot, 3 beats on the other side of a trot, get 6 beats out of it.
Is that the clip-clop that you hear?
Yeah. And also you get delayed timing. If they're dragging too much in that back, a delayed timing between the hind and the front hit, and they should come in on a nice trot and land evenly, right? So if you're going, you know, dragging this down, throws them down the front end, this comes in, or whatever it may be. But it's the timing cadence is going to be out. And, you know, when they walk a horse into the barn, we're getting better with Diego, young horse, not quite getting himself there. We're building up his back end. We've thrown a few other little curves in there to get him to work on building that back end, and it's getting better. But right off, you walk in the barn, don't see the horse move. As a young horse, has been dragging the back end from his barefoot, so the front toes are dragged off a bit. So I don't even have to ask. You know, I can ask the owner how the horse is moving. Oh, he's moving wonderfully. He's really engaging, is he? The hind feet are telling me a different story.
I've been in the barn many times, you know, with my wife. Come down to the barn and help me and stuff. I'm like, okay. You know, for me, it's I hate to say it, it's like watching paint dry. I mean, I understand. I'm learning more and more.
Right.
You know, just doing this show with you, that what to look for and stuff. And I know in my mind, years ago when my wife and I were first started dating, I've seen horses literally come into the aisleway of whatever barn we were at. And dragging its front foot and then setting it down, or dragging the back. And I just thought, wow, that horse must have really worked out hard. It can't pick its feet up. It's lazy. It's tired.
Maybe it's inverted.
I don't know. I'm just
maybe
saying.
Maybe his shoulder's locked up. Maybe he's dropping a shoulder. Maybe he's.
Well, at the time, Mike, I was just like going, God, that poor horse is so tired. He doesn't want to pick his feet up. But mm-hmm. No, this is something totally different.
Right. And it. Rider plays such a big part into it, and as a farrier, we're always at, if people look at something going on with a foot, and sometimes when your barn is, you know, it's hard to get them to relate what's going on with a foot and how tight it is to what's going on up top in the body.
All right, guys, stick around. A couple more segments to get into, and we'll let you get back to enjoying your horses. Stick around. You're listening to Equine Dynamics with Mike Stein. He'll be right back.
Make any kind of sense at all? or is this the word tirade?
I don't know, Mike. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I understand what you're saying, sure. and I know someone else out there understands exactly what you're saying, because I've sat there and let Amy listen to an episode, and you'll go on about this long tirade about something, and I'll be like going, and I'll pause, I go, does that make sense? She's like, yeah, oh, that makes total sense. And I go, okay, keep going. But she does that. She'll listen to the show. She can't listen with me anymore because I'm listening to the technical part. The sound's too loud, or this is, you know, that she's listening to you. She's not listening to, you know, what I'm.
She's sick of hearing you. I know how it works.
Would you shut up, please?
What time is it?
We're at 39 right now.
Okay, so where are we with this? Or is this?
We can do this, and then just come back and do we can do this 5-6 minutes. Is that enough to talk about this, or you want to wait? Because we got one more segment, and then what did we learn today? Or do you want to just skip to this and go, what did we learn today?
Let's skip it, because this can be another 45-minute tirade real easy to do it justice.
Okay. So we'll wait for that. Mm-hmm. You ready?
Yes.
Okay, let me switch cameras, and I'm going to let everyone know. We're going to talk about Peggy Sue next week. Welcome back to Equine Dynamics with Mike Stein. He is now a licensed thoroughbred farrier through the Kentucky Horse Racing Commission. And make sure you follow Mike Stein over on YouTube. The way you do that is to go to Equine Dynamics Mike Stein over on YouTube. Make sure you like and subscribe over there. Mike, I'm seeing all the different posts and all the different comments and stuff. I've had to answer a couple comments that people have been posting on the YouTube channel. So they're interesting out there.
Comments.
Yeah, they're good comments. They're asking like silly questions about basically the way I talk or something like that.
Way you talk.
They're fine with the way you talk. I guess the way I talk a little.
Travis, I like the way you talk.
Well, thank you very much. And if you have a question for Mike Stein, and if you like the way he talks, go over to equinedynamics.com.
You like mustard and biscuits.
I do like mustard and biscuits. Go over to equinedynamics.com. At the top of the page says contact us. Remember, the best question of season 5 will get a free t-shirt, Equine Dynamics t-shirt, so get yours in now and get registered for that. And also, if you'd like Mike Stein to come out to your event or your location, your elementary school, your high school, or anything like that, hit him up over at clinics@equinedynamics.com, fill out that little form there, and he will pencil you and get you scheduled on his rotation. And over to my far hand side is Mike Stein. How are you?
I'm doing good, Travis. How are you doing?
Doing all right. Now, we were going to talk about Peggy Sue. We ran a little bit long there, so we're going to talk about Peggy Sue. We have some video or some pictures and some x-rays of Peggy Sue. We're going to talk about her next week.
Right.
So make sure you stick around for that next week as well. So we're going to what did we learn today, Mike?
Don't stick your finger in a light socket.
No, hold on.
Wait a minute. That's
so
different.
So what do we learn today? Talking terminology, the difference between forging and overreaching.
Yeah, forging, the foot comes into the bottom and hits.
It's like kicking the foot up.
Kicking the foot up, yes. And it's still a timing issue. Overreaching is a bigger timing issue. And
overreaching is stepping on the heels of
stepping on the ball, nailing themselves in the tendon. The faster they go, the further up they can hit.
Now, back to my wife, you know, using the bells on her feet. What are the pads, almost like shin guards that go around the lower hock of the horse's legs? What are those for? Is that from them clipping together, or?
That's for some interference. Yes, a little different arrangement of timing, but yes.
So technically, you should not have those on. Like if your horse is perfect movement, or all horses wear those no matter what. It's kind of like baseball players wearing a cup.
Well, that is one way of looking at things, yes.
Okay, well, I'll erase that and then we'll go. It's kind of like football players wearing pads on their helmets all the time.
Kind of, yeah.
Okay.
Kind of, yeah.
So it's just a safety for the horse no matter what.
Safety for the horse.
So forging is kicking the front foot up with the back heel or the back foot.
Right.
And overreaching is stepping
on the ball with the heels, pulling chunks out and ripping shoes off.
You know what we used to call that in high school when I used to step on the person's shoe as they were walking? We call that a flat tire. You got a flat tire.
You didn't. You're not one of those that intentionally would do such things. I know.
You know, I just say that I used to do it. No, it happened to me all the time.
Yeah.
I was that kid, so I know. Okay. I know exactly what they're talking about.
Did they pick on you, Travis?
Sometimes. And the phases of the stride of the hind end, and why is it important to focus on this?
Well, learning to pay attention to the motor. And when people watch videos of horses, and I get a lot of people looking at dressage horse videos, and oh my God, did you hold up your hand and cover up the front part of the horse?
Okay.
And watch that back end and start telling me how the horse is working. Is it a leg mover or is it a back mover? A back mover is a strong mover, a leg mover is an inverted mover. And if you're watching between the time and between the front and the back, that's where we're getting into some of this interference and forging and overreaching and such things as that. If you've got a lot an activated front end and not a back end, is this true collection? Is this true movement patterns? And are we powering it, lifting through it? Or is it slamming, jamming, bang?
And what are the things, your ham hock and stuff that you got sitting here on the table?
Horse hock. This is a horse hock, and if you look at, which camera are we on?
Doesn't matter. Just do it normally.
The flexion of the joint is directly tied to how low your palmar angle sits, or plantar angle in the back end, palmar angle in the front end. And there's, you know, watching what the body does gives you an idea of what's going on with that kind of an angle, and we should spend more time looking at plantar angle in the hind end of a horse than we do. We look at it at the front pretty regular. We shoot laterals in the front pretty regular, and it's a little more difficult getting really nice laterals on the back end, but we need to pay attention to that. We need to pay attention to what's going on in the coronary band back there and make some good decisions on how to help these guys out.
All right, guys, make sure you follow Mike Stein over on Facebook. The way you do that is search for Equine Dynamics Mike Stein. Mike also puts a bunch of different articles, always furthering educational and learning about horses, equines. You had a bunch of posts up there about Secretariat. It's one of its foals was turned 34 something this year.
Yeah.
So, yeah, a great article on that as well. So if you'd like to read a little bit more the history of different horses that Mike has been accompanied with, or educating, getting more education through Facebook as well. Join him on Facebook. And also, any questions for Mike Stein, get him over to equinedynamics.com. And make sure you follow him on YouTube. Like, subscribe, and comment. And I will answer your comments. If I don't know the answer, I will send
We'll make some comments, too.
Mike will answer them as well. All right, guys, we're going to let you get back to enjoying your horses. On behalf of Mike Stein over there,
have a good day. Enjoy your horses. Enjoy the spring that's coming up here.
My name is Travis Sane. See you next week.
All of the doggies are in the corral.
There you go. Not too bad.
We stumbled through it.
Well, I think the whole the delay of game. Mm-hmm. You know, technicality, 20-second timeout, delay of game.
Right.
Hi, Lucky.